So let's start this out by turning all the lights all the way up for a second so I can see you. There you fucking are. All the way on the top. So I just wanted to take a second, and it's going to take a second because I got to stuff over 30 some years of debauchery into this conversation we're going to have here. Some people think that stuff happens for a reason. I personally think that's a little fucking too new age for me. I think that everything happens because you make a decision. The reason that you guys are here tonight is because you made a decision to get in your car. We made a decision, the four of us, to start a band. And I'm going to kind of break it down. So do you have a second for me? So the first thing we got to do is we all got to sit down together. Let's try that.
You guys can do it. It won't hurt. The guy from here thinks he's in a Mumford and Sons concert right there. Just sit the fuck down. Okay. So this is kind of how this whole thing happened.
It was 1981, late 1980, early 1981, and I was a struggling musician in Los Angeles, California, and I wasn't unique, I wasn't different by the fact that I was struggling, but I was in a band. I came to Los Angeles from Idaho on a Greyhound bus, and I had a fucking idea. I started a band, and I was playing in that band, and for no apparent reason, I looked over at my band during band rehearsal and I said, I'm sorry, but I quit. And at the time, I thought, well, that was probably the stupidest decision that I ever made. And little did I know that it was the beginning of this journey. I didn't have a car. I had a girlfriend. We'll tie her in somehow. I was walking home, I had my bass, and I had a bass amp. And I thought to myself, at that fucking moment, there has to be three other guys in this fucking city of Los Angeles, California, that wants to rip the fucking heart out of the goddamn music industry. Or where they were, or if this was even a good idea. And for no fucking apparent reason, man, this is how life works out. It was a Thursday night. I decided to go to Hollywood, California. I hitched a ride to a club called the Starwood. I walked through the door. I had no fucking idea who was playing that night. I walked through the door, and there was a 17-year-old drummer sitting up there, the skinniest motherfucker I ever seen. He was in a band, I wasn't in a band, so I had an idea. I bought him two beers, myself and rum and coke. He wasn't old enough to drink, and we sit on the floor. You remember that, bro? We sit on the floor, and I know his band was looking at me like, that motherfucker's trying to steal our drummer. And I was. And we talked about something, and this is important in Motley Crue's legacy. We talked about how much we love fucking heavy metal motherfuckers. That we also love fucking punk rock. And something else is we love the bands that came out of the 70s, like Aerosmith, like David Bowie. And as a matter of fact, Alice fucking Cooper. So now I know where the girl comes in. I was living off of her, that's what musicians do. Make enough money to kick them to the curb.
So me and Tommy set up his drums and all those fucking drums in this little front room. I had my bass, and we were playing Too Fast for Love, Public Enemy number one, Starry Eyes. Right. So I guess you get the point. We had the catalyst and we had the heart. We had drums and bass, but we were missing something very important. We're missing a guitar player. So these two boneheads, this is what we did about it. We went to 7-Eleven to buy beer. And at that 7-Eleven, there was a magazine called the Recycler Magazine, and we picked it up, and there it was. Simple as it could be. Loud, rude, aggressive guitar player available. Only call me if you're serious. And then it just said these two words, Mick Mars. I try to make this part of the show shorter, but it keeps getting longer. I just thought of something. Mick came to the door. He had his clothes duct taped together. That's how fucking poor he was. And we set up the three of us, and we started playing these songs. And we were just missing something. We needed a fucking lead singer. Tommy goes, well, I know a guy, but he's in another band. And Mick simply said, because Mick doesn't talk a lot, but when he says shit, he fucking means it. He goes, if he's good, let's steal his ass. So we went back to the Starwood on a Tuesday night, and there he was, our fucking lead singer, in white leather pants, a white leather jacket, decisions to put our band, and we decided also that we didn't want to look like anybody else, sound like anybody else, act, look, smell. We didn't fucking give a fuck. We were gonna fuck everything that got in our fucking way. We were gonna raise hell, and we were gonna crash and fucking burn. We were the only band like us in Los Angeles at the time, and I'm fucking proud of you motherfuckers. Got our money together. I have no idea how we got. We had $26. We went to Burbank, California. We set up in a rehearsal space. And we fucking had one chance. Only one fucking chance. One fucking day. If it didn't work out, we were all gonna have to get a fucking job at McDonald's because none of us even finished fucking high school. We set up. The lyrics to Livewire to Vince, and he simply said, I've got this. Mick turned up his amp, grabbed the guitar, Tommy jumped on the drums, I picked up the bass, and at that exact moment, January 17th, 1981, Motley Crue was fucking born. This is not farewell, and this is not goodbye, because our music is gonna haunt you to the fucking day.